afternoon, everyone. With all the agreements and disagreements in the previous session, we still agree, all of us agree, that children need education for success in life. But it is the perspective towards acquiring it that splits the road, one leading towards mainstream schooling and other towards homeschooling. At the tender age of 3, what could be the motivation to the families to enroll their children in school? Mainly, the reasons are normative or conventional, and nowadays even trendy. Scholastic, obviously, and sometimes it is just convenient for parents to send 3-year toddler to school. Broadly speaking, families opt for homeschooling for religious, circumstantial, that includes health-related and economical circumstances, and philosophical reasons. Theoretically, homeschooling is a child-centric learning, but practically, when child doesn't understand the philosophy behind homeschooling, the practices are often rooted in knowledge, experience, and rationale of the parent. There is no model to homeschooling. The approaches to learning are diverse, highly individualistic to suit the particular need of the family or the child. And that is the beauty and the greatest challenge of homeschooling. The diversity in approaches ranges from parents believe that life was the best teacher and lived happily thereafter, to one parent being the self-proclaimed principal of the homeschool, seeking superlative success for the child. And the most cases lie in between. Regardless of what approach is followed, at times, most homeschooling parents struggle for timely support and resources. But homeschooling parents undoubtedly take privilege in truly seeing who the child is as individual with unique capabilities, interests, talents, and needs. Classroom is not shared with another 20, 30, 40 classmates. Often the world becomes classroom, not just the home or the family. Children have time on their hands and freedom to use it. There is no strict control on what studies have to be completed in a specific frame of time. It is not right that these generic features per se could be termed as the benefits or drawbacks of homeschooling. But they are there, they exist, and that makes homeschooling distinctly different from the mainstream schooling. And then there are other small or big differences, you know, like entire family not getting up to the sound of an alarm with a sole purpose of rushing for that school bus. And children do not have to chew packed food in the recess and don't have to meet the entire family only at the dinner table. Rather, the most appealing to me was that we could plan family holidays whenever we wanted, and especially when other child were struggling to get good marks for their exams. But the most appealing to our homeschool daughters was that they did not need permission to go to loo or wait until the class gets over. In such complex ecosystem of homeschooling, there is no standard benchmark for the evaluation, which is the greatest questioning at socio-legal level to accept it as a sustainable practice for learning. We see 3 names on the screen. These names have faces too, and also the stories how their homeschooling pursuits were evaluated. These 3 young Indian homeschoolers left the mainstream schooling at the age of 12 or 13 years. Shahin Pardiwala pursued his hobbies of reading, blogging, filmmaking during homeschooling years, appeared for class 10 state board exam as a private candidate and secured 93.6%. Board examinations by NIOS, state boards, and IG board, allowing private candidates to register, is the most common means of evaluation for homeschoolers to switch to mainstream. Harshita Arora, a girl from a small town in Uttar Pradesh, eventually gave up the idea to appear for class 10. At the age of 16, the girl was completely occupied designing her own mobile app. Crypto Price Tracker ranked second in the list of top paid apps in the finance category of Apple's App Store within a month of its launch. The 17-year-old girl is presently working in USA on a brain-computer interface project. In this manner, homeschoolers have been evaluated by their performance in respective fields. Malvika Raj Joshi left formal schooling to be able to discover subjects beyond the school curriculum. She explored many subjects from music to language to windsurfing before she developed interest in coding. In absence of her high school transcripts, that is the certificate and mark sheets that we get, Massachusetts Institute of Technology in USA assessed her portfolio and mentor's recommendation, thereby admitting her to the undergrad course with scholarship. There are many other colleges in US that rely on holistic assessment of homeschoolers in absence of the high school transcripts. These cases do not make homeschooling a better or a bad choice, neither means for success. It just means that these children succeeded in evaluating their homeschooling pursuits without attending mainstream schools. Even in the most thoughtfully designed master plan for education, homeschooling cannot be one solution for all. Homeschooling is on the rise, especially in metro cities, but the practice has not yet redefined itself into a legitimate, well-respected means of educating our youth. There is tons of information available on internet about homeschooling, mostly tempered with opinions. For new homeschooling families, especially with no real-life connection with other homeschoolers, it becomes difficult to seek precise and authentic information. Hopefully, a clear and positive stand towards homeschooling by the government could result in an official forum to offer nitty-gritty of homeschooling. For ambiguity about legalities of homeschooling, many families do not want to openly share their homeschooling status on social media or other forums. In interiors of India, homeschooling families struggle to connect with the community. Without such connections, sometimes homeschooling might become a lone journey for the child or for the family. Being a minority is not a pleasant experience. Moreover, sometimes society has more impact on a child than its own parents. The child might go through silent yearning for what is he missing without being able to vocalize the concern, and moreover, without being able to visualize the reasons why parents chose such situation. I am not pessimistic about homeschooling. I have homeschooled my two daughters, and those years were the best years of my life. I am the proud mother of Malvika Raj Joshi. But while the current mainstream model has failed to cater the needs of children and no transformation can happen overnight, all we can do is to synergize the different practices. Fellow homeschoolers and mentors have some ideas to propose to this convention on the same. Freedom of choice. Can we feel free to use self-learning spaces in current formal setup of schools? Like the other practitioners of different models have presented. Flexi schedules in schools, eliminating fixed timetables, even for breaks, especially for young children who tune into and listen to their own bodies to follow the signals of tiredness, sleep, waking up, change of activities, etc. Effective bridging assessments. Evaluation, I like that evaluation is to give value to such programs to join mainstream at any level without requiring the pre-qualifications. Under curriculum, can we have a curriculum relevant to real life context? Equal merit for vocational subjects just as math and science. Soft skills as a part of learning? Yes. Well-being, best practices for maintaining physical and mental well-being of the children. By age 12 or 14, when they are awakened intellectually and start using technology for self-learning, all they might need is the support, not a strict framework for learning. Respect. Respect to whom? To the living planet. Best environmental practices to respect the planet, not just to be taught, but to be practiced by schools. Co-learning of teachers, students, parents, and communities to respect each other. Inclusion of artisans or barefoot faculty for imparting skills. Can we call cleaners as hygiene faculty to teach hands-on hygiene? Have we thought about it? Can a carpenter guide students to repair benches and chairs? Can a cobbler come to school just as a respected faculty? Can we create a space in school for children to be respected for whoever they are and with whatever strains and challenges they have? Action. Action for strict implementation of guidelines about giving punishments to children or the load that they carry on their backs, the strict implementations. More relevant hands-on, practical learning rather than learning from books. Break out the classrooms. Don't sit in one place. Keep moving. Can educational institutes be looked upon as resources or research centers, giving the students an opportunity to work on real-life projects? Holistic assessments over the standard exam-based evaluations. Strong evaluation of whatever, strong evaluation of whether the policies are being implemented with the alignment of the purpose of the policy. Assessments or evaluations are inevitable, but in the modern human rights framework, we need to redefine their nature and the purpose. Assessments are not to provide directions only to learners, but also to teachers and the system. A child with 100% attendance in school, who maintained complete discipline, completed homework and all the assignments in time, but performed poor in evaluation, who is responsible? The system should ensure that evaluations will neither hammer personal well-being, like a child losing confidence or committing a suicide, nor the personal growth, like unjustified denial for an opportunity in learning. At the top, there are children who commute to schools in chauffeur-driven cars or perform excellent in exams. At the bottom, parents use their own children with whatever skill set they have given to their children as a means of earning money. then there is a big set of children who is performing just ordinary, and another big set attending aided schools and performing terrible in exams. But both are highly dependent on the system to make a successful life. As per census 2011, 37 crore children in India are under 14 years. The demographic, economic, cultural, behavioral dynamics makes it difficult to offer one practice of learning for all. As Priya Desikan, a fellow homeschooler, quotes, "We should stop categorizing practices as alternative or mainstream and simply give each child whatever he needs to grow and to flourish." Thank you so much.